Is all money legitimate money?
If it can clear a check, if the check clears, if the check clears, it's legit.
It almost feels as though, as women, mm-hmm. we have to be doubly careful mm-hmm. of the, you know, the content or the things that we put online.
Mm-hmm. Just because it's an innovation doesn't mean it's free of any flaw.
Whether or not we agree with your profession is one thing, but I can also respect that there is a level of expertise behind it.
Technology makes it easy to dehumanize people. Yeah, yeah. The incentivization of falling in love, right?
Hello and welcome to the Two My Sisters podcast. I'm Courtney.
And I'm Renee, and we are your online sisters and hosts of the Two My Sisters podcast.
We are all about promoting the wellness, growth, and development of a community of sisters around the world.
And in today's episode, we're going to be talking about money by any means necessary.
Oh, no.
NPC. Side hustle, sex, work, foot fetishes, and if we have time, dating online for money.
Okay.
Love Island.
Oh, dating shows.
Dating shows, competition. Baby. Dating shows, money. It is hard out in these streets. Telling and money you, FMA.
Cost of living crisis.
It's a crisis, but it also comes with new avenues for making money, especially online.
Innovation.
And we have
sites.
We have seen many an innovation recently that would be worth having a conversation
definitely.
About.
Definitely.
And more so around propriety, respectability. Is this a legitimate way to make money, especially given the nouveau capitalism? And also, what are our thoughts? Because I just think these are such interesting ways to make money.
Very interesting.
But before we do that, we do have some housekeeping. We've got to sweep the house, and we've got some exciting housekeeping. We've got some new products to use on our ovens and our floors, and you know, as you can see,
sisters, something that we have been working on for since 2022. It's been a long time.
Oh, you're right, you know.
Open your diary now, okay? Go to October day 27. Yeah, 27th of October.
Yeah, yeah.
Here in our home city of London, we are having our biggest, baddest, best live show.
Yeah,
My sisters live in London, year three,
baby. We 3 years in the making.
Let's go.
We have a
and
toddler.
Guess where we are gonna be?
You ain't even ready for it, baby.
Hackney Empire.
Empire, because the we're iconic Empire Builders.
Hackney
Empire Builders.
Empire.
Empresses.
Well,
call us Empresses. We're taking over the Empire of Hackney. Let's go, baby.
Yes, sisters, we are having our annual podcast live show at Hackney Empire this year on October 27th. It is a Friday night your sisters, and we cannot wait to bring you the show that we have been working on. Some special guests, some special treats, some important announcements.
Crazy.
We are so excited for you to join us, to come and meet amazing women who listen to the podcast. And you guys know we've been going hard with our, you know, events here and there, but honestly, the London live show is something that's so close to our heart.
Yep.
Being that TMS started in London,
you know.
And so, sisters, we're gonna be here. We want you to be there. And so tickets come out on Friday, August the 5th, okay? Or Friday the 4th of August, I should say. So set your alarms for bright
and early.
Tickets go on sale, and you guys already know.
Every
year we do what? Sell out.
Hello.
And so please help us sell out one. It's bigger. It's better.
It's better.
It's badass. It's the
baddest. Yeah.
Come on. So we need you to be there.
Bring all, hey, brothers. Brothers. You want to sit in the sideline somewhere in the dark, you know, just chuckling and whatnot.
Yes, this is our first event that is open to both men and women.
Yep,
apart from our book.
And
book
all folks, show. To be honest with you.
Yeah.
And non-binary folk. We don't care where you are hailing from. Obviously, we are going to prioritize the sisters as much as possible. But if you do think that you are an ally to the work that we are doing and you could lend a supporting ear, we would love to also see you there. It's going to be a celebration of all things sisterhood. And as is customary, you're going to be hearing from us, but there's some big players that are coming. Like, I don't think you guys do get, like, Hackney Empire.
Honestly.
Like, that means that there's a level up. Like, there's a level
guys.
Up. But also the sisters that we're bringing.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we wouldn't ask you to leave your house for nonsense.
On a Friday on your
We wouldn't ask you to leave your house for nonsense, okay? So honestly, we're working on making this the best show we have ever had. And we want you to be a part of it. Absolutely. Honestly, TMS is nothing without the sisters. Honestly. And so this is a night to celebrate you guys, to celebrate our third year anniversary. Look at all that we've been able to do through the power of community, you and us, okay? Over the last 3 years. And so please come and join us. Come and have fun. Honestly. It's such an iconic venue in London. Absolutely. I mean, it's Hackney Empire now. Might be O2 next year. Might be O2 next year.
Percolating, manifesting, percolating, percolating. Pray,
glory be.
That's what we do. We pray the prayer. So sisters, open your purse and open your prayers. Yes, stay in your prayer closet, because we feel the need everything. All the prayers that you can send us.
Come out and support. Honestly, some of you have been to every single live show, and so we really hope we do get to see you again. If you've never been, come bring a friend. If you can't bring a friend, come and meet new friends. People often do at the live shows. It is going to be a night full of laughter, of real deep conversation, but also sistering. Can we make sistering a verb?
We're going to make it a word, but we need to trademark it, because we know there's some heifers out there that's called pastor. No. There's somebody out there that's like, ooh, sistering.
Sistering.
I like that. Yeah. We're sistering a generation.
There we go.
Our mission is to sister a lost generation that doesn't know platonic friendship or sisterhood.
That's exactly what you're going to experience on Friday, the 27th of October. Sistering. It's an active word.
I like that.
Thank you. Trademarked. Don't be stupid.
You heard it here first.
There we go.
Don't do that. So sisters, we would appreciate all your love, all your support. If you see it, share it. If you are able to come, like, we know that we're biased towards London. You know, this venue situation is not easy, baby. Guys. So our Midlands babes, like all of our babes down south, we are so sorry, but we would love to see you. And honestly, you know, well in advance, so you know you can get them Chiltern Railway tickets. You know, we're currently on strike now. The Chiltern Railway, Avanti West Coast. We might even need to get some sponsorships, child.
Be get like the sisters into London, honestly. But maybe this is actually the beginning. This is our third London live show, and so maybe this really is the beginning of us venturing out into other parts of the UK. But for now, London is the only one on the roster, and so please
get those train
show
tickets.
Up for this one. Get the train tickets and let us know also where you are, so that we can think about future ones as well.
For sure. Well, sisters, it's so exciting. I feel all hard and bothered because I'm so excited for this. So if you see us pushing a live show, like,
please come.
To the point where, and also just to talk about some of our other experiences, because we know we wanted to do a summer day out and we also wanted to do a winter weekender. All of you know that it's just us two and a handful of incredible women that we have that are working with us. Unfortunately, because there are so few of us and we are working,
we don't have the capacity.
We want to make sure that this is the flagship experience, which has meant that we had to make the difficult decision to sideline the summer day out as well as the winter weekender. However, there is still the international trips to sign up to if you would like to be part of our excitement. This will be occurring both in Ghana and South Africa. So come and party with the girls internationally. Yeah. Otherwise, live in London is about to be our biggest event. Yeah. And it requires all of our energy.
It really is. And honestly, like, we wanted to just funnel all of our resources into making sure we were giving you the best experiences ever. We don't half-ass anything. You guys already know that around here. And so we just wanted to be wise with how we do things, but also we are planning our 2024 calendar. And so definitely stay tuned to hear other opportunities for you to come and link up with us then. But if you want a little prelude, a little taste of what that could be like, then show up to the live show for sure.
Absolutely appreciate 100. It. And we are looking forward to seeing you. And this is going to be a transformative night. It's not just you're listening to a podcast show. This is a production, baby. This is transformative. Thank you're coming you. To be transformed, changed, renewed, if you will. And it will be one of the biggest women's event in London. Heck, the UK, baby. The UK. So don't miss out.
We're
giving
honestly.
You months of notice. If you miss out, I don't know what to tell you.
I know what to tell you. Tickets could be gold, whatever. We'll leave the link In the mailing list. I was about to say in the description, but no.
You need to go to the mailing
list. It will
list.
Be on the mailing list. So sign up. Just put your email in at tomysisters.com. We send you weekly going and growing tips in the form of our newsletter, but also we will send you the link directly to your inbox so that you do not lack, you do not lose, okay?
We're all winners here.
There you
don't
go.
Don't be a loser.
Don't be a loser. Because I'm not trying to hear, oh, I couldn't find the link. Mm-mm.
Our phones are going to be shut off. There we go. We don't want to hear any excuses.
Oh my gosh, I was trying to get to...
And we've actually even got tickets for those of you that want to bring a sister.
There we go.
So even if your sister is lacking, you better look. We
buy
got
two at the same time.
We got some discounts.
Yeah,
special
buy
discounts.
A group ticket. This is the thing. We actually wanted to encourage you all to bring a friend. And so if you're looking to come to the live show with, you know, a sister, a bestie, a colleague even who you want to just have a nice night out with, then you can actually get friend tickets, bring a sister tickets where you get two tickets at a discounted price.
Absolutely.
So definitely find your friends who you want to get tickets with and make sure that they transfer you the money. All right,
absolutely, absolutely. Don't lack. Remember, sistering involves it involves
active
getting your
verb.
It involves getting your ticket.
There you go.
So thank you. In terms of other housekeepings, I know we actually wanted to do a whole episode on this, but you know, reflecting on like two of my sisters just generally where we've come and all that kind of stuff. I know folks that may be listening to us say on like Spotify and other kind of streaming channels may have noticed we have ads now. There's so many
updates.
Major changes.
So cast your mind back to November 2020. Two best friends are sitting in a childhood bedroom, okay, just chatting on some microphones, right? And they call the episode Frenemies. Goes out into the interweb, wherever that is.
The ethosphere.
Whatever that means. And suddenly now they have this massive sisterhood community who they're trying to change the world with, right? Then they quickly realize this requires money. So one thing we want to keep improving here at TMS are things like the Vision Fund, which round two is coming real soon. And actually, Yoko, she wants to be on the pod real soon.
We have so many things.
Exactly. There is so much. But as you guys have seen over the last 3 years, whether you are new to the channel, to the journey, to the sisterhood, or you have been here since episode one, season one, is that we are doing women's work. And women's work takes resources, not just money, but also networks and all that stuff. But again, money, right? Being able to expand things like the Vision Fund in 2024, to be able to invest in more of your projects next year, is something that we really want to do. Being able to build more schools, because we're close to closing our 10K goal on the Bright Future Academy in Tamale, Ghana. Being able to donate to girls' digital education. Being able to donate more to women's homelessness across the world, not just in the UK. We've sown so many seeds in different areas through the power of content and the content that we give you, but we needed to amp it up in some way. And many people will let you know content creation can be a tough road,
right?
Because securing advertisement partnerships and stuff like that can be difficult, and so it makes you then rely on your community members to kind of give you money. And you guys have been so generous to donate and stuff like that, but we're also very aware we are in a cost of living crisis,
right?
And there is only, we don't want to come to you every week and there's something else for you to put money into. Obviously we want to give you worthwhile causes to be generous towards, but again, we don't want you to have to be, you know, putting loads of money towards us. And so what we did want to do is go and get money from the people who have it, which is advertisers.
Hello.
All right. And so a couple months ago in March, we actually signed to a new management, which I don't think we announced either. We have managers now. And the whole reason for that was strategic partnerships. We don't want to just have, you know, sponsors or managers or for saying it.
Right.
We actually want it to provoke change.
Right.
And for us, strategic partnerships currently look like having ads running on our podcast. So if you are listening to our podcast and you hear an advertisement pop up, or you're listening to another podcast and you may hear my voice or Renee's voice pop up talking to you about a brand, one thing you need to trust about us, we ain't going to endorse nothing we don't use or we don't like. Okay,
straight up.
How about that?
Straight
I know
up.
We're about to talk about money in
hello,
a second
hello.
All right, but we ain't doing integrity.
Yeah, baby,
integrity
is picky right here, baby.
There we go.
Hello.
And so please do support. If you hear an ad, it's going to be for like a minute or so, or even 30 seconds. Please listen through to it, because you guys know the content game already. That is how we make money. Right. But it's not how we make money in terms of money in our pocket. It's how the sisterhood is making money and it's growing. And our prayers and our vision is that we'll be able to fund things like scholarships, more education, build more schools, build more shelters, do women's work globally, and also invest in you guys' visions as well. 100%. And we are blessed to have this platform. We are blessed to have a podcast which has been downloaded nearly 5 million times. Crazy. Right? That is absolutely insane. And if advertisers can peddle some of the money back into us, and then we can give it back to you guys, please listen to the ads. Support us. Essentially. Listen to the ads.
The sisterhood needs money. We need capital. We need real investment. Honestly. And literally, like, full transparency, me and Courtney don't get paid by Two Man Sisters.
We don't.
Baby, we be reinvesting.
We do this, what? Pro bono. Pro bono.
These voices be getting real expensive now, though. We're getting pricey. But yeah, TMS does not pay us. We reinvest everything that we make, or everything that is to do with Two My Sisters, back into our community. And there's very few content creators, or very few folks that have the opportunity to do that. And it is hard. You know, it means we have to make our coin elsewhere. Yeah. And, you know, we're doing really well, but it means that's an additional thing where we need to ensure that the sisterhood has really efficient systems to ensure that it's still running, that you get to see our beautiful faces, but also we do, as Courtney said, women's work. So please support us.
100%. And so many of you have actually approached, like, want to intern, want to help in some way. And for us, we don't want to take advantage of anybody. Right. If we can pay you for the work, or pay you for this, the skill set and the talents that you bring to the table, we want to be able to do that and expand this team. 100%. But again, salaries are what? Cash dollar. And so we really, really want to be able to radically grow this organization. Yeah. And we want you to believe in it and listen to the advertisements if you can.
It starts there. All we need you to do is buy a live show ticket and listen to some airbus.
Please do. But let us know how we can continue to provide you with value on the podcast. Even though ads will be running, it will not dilute the quality of the podcast. The advertisements will be high quality as well. But like I said, we ain't endorsing nothing we don't use or like.
Genuinely. Mm-mm. Like, we've sat down with our team and said, look, we ain't used this, that. We ain't,
100%. What is their background? What is their track record? Excuse how do me? They treat women?
Yeah.
Are their products even good?
Do we like them?
Do we use it?
Do we use it? So sisters, we appreciate your patience, we appreciate your love and your continued support. We've got some big stuff on the way over at Team My Sisters headquarters, and we would love if you continue to pour that love right back into us. But there is another sister in need of the pouring into, you know, their loving and all that
crazy stuff,
because we are starting with a ding ding ding
dilemma.
Let's get into it.
All right.
Hey friends.
Hey friend.
I'm a 30-year-old sister from Chicago and love your content.
Thank you.
I'm recently single after ending a 3-year relationship and navigating the single space again. I've been watching Courtney's videos. If you don't know, Courtney is a YouTuber, by the way, and I think you should go and subscribe right now. About single eras, and she asked a question that shook me to my core. Oh, she stays shaking the girls. That's Courtney.
It's my calling.
If you were to get married tomorrow, could you say you made the most of your single time? I truly can't say that I have, so I'm challenging myself to invest in me during my 30s the way I invested in dating during my 20s. Mm. What are some tangible ways to really enjoy your single era in ways that are centered around yourself instead of finding a partner? Thank you for all you do.
Oh, man. I love this question so much. I stay talking about singleness. It's bittersweet.
It's the way that you got all nervous, like, oh, I love it.
Talking about it. Because honestly, I think it's such an underrated season currently in our, like, culture where everyone's like, babe, relationship goals, vacations, dates, everything. And it's like, oh, but guys, if we want to have, like, marriages that last forever, once we get married, we ain't going to be single again until our partners pass. Or we might pass first. You know,
I personally hope this sounds so morbid, but I would like to go first.
I gotta go.
I gotta go.
I can't. That whole like going by the window, looking where is my no.
I gotta go.
I gotta go first,
or I will be a tyrant to society. You're it.
No, like, no, 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 I can't. I can't.
Anyway, romantic stuff. But I do think that singleness and like our single era is something that people don't talk about enough, and I think it's often painted with disdain.
Yeah,
which
yeah.
is, oh my gosh, I'm single. When am I gonna be in a relationship? And it's something right. that we don't do actively. And so the reason why I make single content is because I want people to know you can actually be single and happy,
yeah.
and you can make the Facts. Most of this season, because this season actually comes with benefits. And I think that's what's not never highlighted, like being Facts. Single actually comes with benefits. It's not that it's better than being married, and it's not that being married is better than being single. Mm-hmm. I actually think you just need to learn to leverage every season and the opportunities that are within yeah. a season. And so how to, and I love that you mentioned the dilemma, sis, like how do you practically make the most of this of your singleness without it being oriented around getting a partner? Because oftentimes people are like, oh, do XYZ so that you can like, or go so here so you can get meet a partner. Do you get what I mean? So you can meet these kind of guys, or do this so that you have interesting stories to tell when you start dating. And it's like, whoa, let's decenter the partner for a second and let's center ourselves, right? And let's center our experiences and doing things which actually fulfill us. And the reason why I asked that question in a video was because I want to be able to look back at like 50, 60 when I've had my kids and be like, before I had y'all, I did everything I needed to do.
She was that girl.
I was that girl.
Let me tell you about your auntie Courtney.
Let me tell you, before I had all of you guys, before I met your daddy and all of this,
right.
I did the things that I needed to do. Do you know what I mean? Before I had the responsibility, and maybe I would have had to make certain sacrifices. And I think that's the beauty of actually relationships and serious relationships and building a family. Like, you get to make a sacrifice because you want to, but nonetheless, it is a sacrifice. And that comes with a certain degree of what ifs or losses or, you know, things like that. Not to frame it super sad, but let's just be real. If it's a sacrifice, it comes with a bit of a, you know, it's a sacrifice.
Hello.
And so practical ways to make the most of your singleness, actually start inspecting, what do you like? What are your dreams? Now, it's because a lot of women don't ask themselves these questions, Renee.
No, you're
they don't
right. don't ask themselves. It's when you hear it, you're like, damn.
It's that simple. But it's like a lot of us don't actually ask ourselves these questions. Like, I love cinema, right? And I feel like dating is then like, I love cinema. I love eating certain foods. Like, I love sushi. I love, what else? I love travel, right? I actually love exploring new cultures. I found this out about myself whilst I was a single base, whilst I'm a single babe. And the reason why I wanted to find that out about myself was so that I wasn't delaying my gratification. I wasn't delaying my happiness until a partner came and unlocked these parts of me suddenly. No, I wanted to know who I was so that I knew who I was also looking for and who I could actually make a relationship work with based on the person who I know myself to be, right? I enjoy XYZ. I can't be with a person who's like, I don't want to explore any other country in the world. I want to stay in my small town. Okay, that's you. But what about me?
What about my name?
Do you know what I mean? But it's also now learning, okay, cool. So you're not for me. And I think this also helps us in dating, because we then start dating with intention and we start dating with the intention of finding someone who's actually for us versus trying to mold ourselves to be for them. Do you get what I mean? And I think back to what I was saying, like decentering the relationship aspect, once you become acquainted with your desires, 100%. Which is a phrase that I really want women to like meditate over, like become acquainted with your own desires. What do you want out of your life? What do you want to be able to say you've done, you've seen, you've experienced? And genuinely, the things that you love, it doesn't have to be that you delay experiencing those things until you have a relationship or until you have kids. You can actually do it with your friends. You can do it by yourself. Solo travel if you want to. Go out and see museums, learn new things. The time that you have now, like, use it, like genuinely just use the time you have to somewhat be selfish or to serve your wider community, right? But it doesn't have to be that I won't be in my fullest self, my brightest self, I won't shine as a person until a partner comes and unlocks that for me. So I think now is the time to ask yourself these really deep questions. Who am I? What do I like? What do I want out of life?
Not the who
what
am
do
I?
Yeah, who am I? What do I want to explore and get out of this very big, beautiful world? do I want to do, you know, do I want to learn something? Do I want to give back something? You know, do I want to build a school? Like, all of these stuff are things that you can actually do in your single era. You don't have to wait for anything to catapult you into that. And I think leveraging the fact that you only really have to think about yourself right now helps you to do these things in a way more free way. You're not thinking about other people's schedules and other people's needs. Absolutely. All you're thinking about is yourself. You don't have to think about, oh, but are my children's school fees going to be paid? You know, people, so Johnny needs new socks. You're just thinking about yourself. You're just thinking about yourself.
No, but Johnny needs new socks, and he needs new socks and a new blazer every year.
And a new, and it's not gonna stop. It's not gonna, at least for 18 years, according to Kanye. So honestly, like, you, so honestly, like, just embracing these very simple questions, which we often don't ask ourselves because we're thinking of ourselves in relative to a partner that doesn't exist yet.
That's good.
No, think about yourself. Who are you? What do you like? What do you want? And start doing those things. And if you don't know what those things are, experiment. Like, this is an amazing time to experiment. Go to different places, talk to different people, explore different activities, which may even be free to attend. Just go on, like, you know, Eventbrite, events near me. What's happening? Go by yourself or drag a friend to come with you. And you may find that you're interested in different things, and you may find hobbies for yourself. But like I said, there are so many different things you can do to actually, like, make the most of your single time or your single season. And it doesn't have to be all about doing things alone. This is why, like, for me, the message of sisterhood is so important. And I'm so happy that I was able to lock into the fact that friendship and the presence of other women and sisterhood in your life is so important whilst I was single. Because it meant I was able to give my friends that time. I was able to give them the affection and the attention. And I'm not going to sit here and sound like, oh, singleness is hunky-dory, but singleness is what you make it, right? And the same way marriage can come with challenges, but it's beautiful because it's what you make it, is the same way singleness is full of challenges, but it's beautiful depending on what you make it. So choose to make this season beautiful.
Wow. A word.
A word.
A stringing together of many words.
I try.
That just penetrated the soul.
I'm screaming. It's when you've been single for like 7 years, girl.
It does something.
You learn something. You have to learn something. You have to learn something.
No, I absolutely love everything that you said. Yeah. And I'll just pick up on that last, almost in reverse, where you were talking about like community.
Yeah.
Your singleness is the time for you to really think about community. Yes. Who are the people around you? Your friends, your family members. Yeah. You might be rediscovering stuff about your family members and treating them as friends finally. It's really an opportunity to invest into a lot of your platonic relationships, because one thing that we find is that a lot of women, we get into relationships and then all of a sudden our friendships are strained or like our relationship with our family becomes strained. And it's a lot easier for you to maintain those relationships if you had a good standing in the first instance. Many of us don't have good standing with our family or our friends. So pick what to start tomorrow.
Facts. Or you come to these, you know, times, key milestone moments, for example, and you realize you don't actually have a village or a community around you to support you. I was talking about this with my mum recently, and she was like, you know, so many people get married and they have no one to invite to their wedding. They have no community. Village. They're dating. They don't even know who to call on for accountability or counseling,
right?
Because they don't have a village of people who knew them before they, you know, got into a relationship. These things don't just appear because, you know, you found a partner. You start building them.
You have to start building them when you're single, because they're not just going to magically appear when you get into a relationship or gravitate towards you. You two have to be attractive to people. And I think it's that, right? Being attractive to people and not just to a potential partner. And I think I love what you're saying around decentering, because how often do we hear the framing of singleness for men in preparation to be a husband? No, it's always your singleness for women is in preparation to be a good wife. And it's like, man, being single is so much more than that. It's actually just enjoying time in your presence and existing. Like, it's actually okay to exist. Finding out your hobbies, doing things that you like, discovering what you actually like so that you can ensure that you are not abused, that you are not brainwashed, ensure that people don't come lording anything over you.
Yeah, but also that you don't settle.
Exactly. And that you retain a sense of your individuality.
Yes.
Like, that's so important, because look, whether or not you decide to become a mother or, you know, a partner or whatever, you will like not lose the fact that you're an individual.
Yeah.
And I think even having conversation with some of my friends that are mothers, yeah, it's the, for them, it was like the realization, oh, I have a kid, but I still have things that I really enjoy doing, or I still like am me. Like I just have a child, yes, but I still am very much me. I, yes, don't morph into some kind of, yeah, some kind of just the mother. It is, I am me, but a mother, literally just that.
Yeah.
So really spending time to actually discover yourself is so, yes, important, and don't allow that work to be done by other people, because that's where other people can manipulate you, yeah, control you, and not necessarily force you, but compel you into being something that you're actually not, because you didn't take the time to discover who you were in the first place.
Yeah.
And really enjoy it. Do fun things. Like, really prioritize fun. You know, I think sometimes as well, we can prioritize doing a lot of like work.
Yeah, personal development.
Personal development. I'm becoming the best person that I can be.
Free.
Sometimes it's just about, I just want to enjoy. I want to do, I want to have experiences that if I were in a relationship or if I had a family, it would be proved difficult, yeah, right? You really want to, life is so short, sis. Like, go out there and do things, right? Really prioritize being a doer, a, yeah, mover and a shaker. You're single. You can move around, oh, baby.
You can move and shake.
You can move and shake, baby. You can move around. You could go to another country, yeah, at whatever time you want to, especially being in your 30s. I feel like you're actually
with the disposable income.
Because you know, you're in your 20s, baby. Maybe you have the blueprint, baby. We're all talking about, yeah, let's find our bae in 20s. And then, you know, maybe we should do it in the reverse. Maybe. You know what I'm saying? But honestly,
yeah,
enjoying that time. Yeah. Allowing yourself to unplug, unsubscribe, yeah, from all the nonsense. Go out with your friends. Go and have fun.
Explore you, man.
Honestly, and this is beautiful, not to say that you won't like be lonely at some points. Mm-hmm. There will be some points. And I think that's important. Even though too many people try and shame women into toxic relationships, yeah, because, you're going to be lonely and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. But it is better to be lonely than disturbed.
That's
by
good.
People and things that have absolutely no business being in your life.
Facts.
I would rather be alone with multiple cats.
There you go.
Than with somebody that is,
that's
actively,
what makes me happy.
Do you know what I mean? Than with somebody or something or the presence of things in my life that other people have said are for me. You want to make sure that, you know, when you are ready, when you are not even ready in the sense of you're perfect, but, yeah, when you're ready, I think there's a difference between readiness and perfection as well. Because I think many of us think I need to be a perfect person to be able to enter into that, yeah, relationship or whatever. And we spoke about this, yeah, in one of our previous episodes on overcoming trauma. There's a difference between perfection and readiness. Readiness says I've committed to the journey of continuing to be better every single day. Perfection says I have to be at this particular level before I allow myself to get specific things into my life that I think are blessings or whatever. Mm. It's very much around, once you are ready to commit to that journey, then girl, you are ready.
Yeah.
But before you ready, you ain't ready. And, yeah, that's fine. Go outside.
Yeah, go outside and enjoy. Do your thing. And also, these two are not mutually exclusive. Like, your singleness period may still be filled with different dating experiences.
Absolutely.
And meeting new people, and
absolutely,
at least you know you haven't got this pressure now of trying to force yourself into something that isn't a fit for,
mm-hmm,
you,
mm-hmm.
And the last thing I wanted to say on it as well is, this is a great time to practice contentment, because I think a lot of us think that we'll suddenly become content,
right,
and grateful people, yep, right, with positive outlooks and happiness,
yep,
once we get everything that we want. But if you do not know how to practice contentment, gratitude, mm-hmm, and happiness before you get everything that you desire, right, especially, yep, like the additional things, not the essential stuff. Obviously, if you're poor, it's hard to,
yep,
exercise gratitude, contentment, yes, and happiness. But those things, if it's like, oh no, once I get my partner, then I'll be content, grateful, and happy. Nah, not necessarily, right?
Annoying.
These are things that you practice. And so this is a great time to learn how to be content, mm-hmm, how to be happy, how to be grateful, how to see the good in situations. And I do think it's just a way of training your mind, because, mm-hmm, I think a lot of times we can default into complaining. Oh, I'm single. This means I'm lonely. This means I don't feel, yeah, beautiful. I don't feel valuable. But those insecurities won't necessarily go away. Mm-hmm. But also that way of thinking won't necessarily be corrected just because a partner is present.
Yeah.
Because now you're just going to point out, but he's not like this. He's not like that. He doesn't do X, Y, Z.
Look.
You train your mind in discontentment, right? And so this is a great time to practice contentment and allow that to then be transferred over, that positive outlook and that mindset to be transferred over into fostering a healthy relationship.
And some partners are annoying. In fact, all partners are
annoying. Or everyone. You're annoying.
Everyone is annoying. So don't think that you're going to... of course, we speak peace into all mm-hmm. relationships, but there will be some tough times.
Yeah.
It is a different type of work, and it's better that you're prepped and ready for that work.
Yeah, exactly.
Not having to force yourself to go through this entire like cycle preparing. Do you know what I mean? Like, have some... enjoy the good old days. Take some pictures and stuff like that, you know, all that kind of stuff.
And it's easier to learn someone else when you know how to learn yourself. Once you've practiced learning yourself and the ups and downs that come with that and the patience that's required,
right,
you then find it easier to learn other people, because then you realize, actually, this is the process I went through analyzing myself and becoming self-aware. And so now I can understand how to accept you, flaws and all, because I've done it for me.
And you can be a more interesting person. Exactly. You don't want to be that person that's just like, I'm here. Yeah, I'm here for you, babe. That's it. But it's like, okay, so what do you like? What do you do? What things, you know, set your soul on fire? I want you in your single period to find the things that set your soul on fire. Like things that just make you excited, happy, distinctive things. Because that's a superpower in today's society. But sis, we are sending you so much love in this season of your life. How exciting. We hope you also find healing. I know a 3-year relationship is T for tight, and coming out of that, we're just praying for healing. We hope that you overcome, and you know, whenever you do find your partner, obviously we are praying peace into that and happiness 100%. And all the fruitful things. But up until then, sis, enjoy
live your time, please.
Live it. And to all our single ladies out there, enjoy your time, baby. Enjoy. Because, baby, when you get into a relationship, that's a whole nother, that's a whole nother kettle of fish, as they say. And the married sisters, the sisters in relationships will attest to that. Well, moving on to the meat and bones, main course of the conversation, which is on money after make.
Yeah.
And we've had conversations on money after make, you know, numerous times. But what's really interesting right now, especially for women, is that it feels as though there's quite a few interesting avenues to make money.
Yes.
Now, you are no stranger to, you know, creating content, thinking about more digital ways to earn money, being an entrepreneur that's primarily e-commerce.
Primarily digital.
You're no stranger to utilizing these new internet tools, online tools, interesting stuff, you know, to be able to
speciality.
Is something like that, something like a specialty. You're definitely no stranger to it. And that in of itself in that period came with all sorts of interesting conversations that you've had around, is what I'm doing legitimate? Is it valid? That kind of stuff. And I think what's even more interesting is we've continue to progress into spaces where we're seeing women make money from some very, very unique, new and interesting ways. Mm-hmm. While some of the kind of like premises, so for example, things like sex work or things like, you know, prying into like fetishes and stuff like that have been a tried and tested way to, you know, make money. The tools are now very, very different, but equally there are some women who are making money from very interesting things that don't require them to, you know, be sexual, and whatever.
In comes Miss Pinky Doll.
In comes Miss Pinky Doll. So for context, for those of you that have no idea what NPC means or who Miss Pinky Doll is, she has been taking the world by storm. Yeah. Essentially NPC stands for non-player characters. Yeah, so in a video game, you'll have the characters that you can play. So for example, in Sims, and then you'll have the folks that you go over to, and they can't say that much. Yeah. They don't do that much stuff. There is a old but now resurfaced fetish for a lot of people where they enjoy seeing people act out these non-playable characters. Yeah. In comes Miss Pinky Doll, who is a French-Canadian lady on TikTok who actually has live streams where she is cosplaying as an NPC. The world set on fire because they couldn't believe that she was making, I believe, between $4,000 to $7,000 per stream, per live stream, per hour. And folks were just gifting her with money after they've, you know, put an emoji into the chat, and she would, you know,
TikTok gifts
demonstrate,
which is like TikTok gifts have monetary value.
And what that opened up was a very interesting conversation around legitimate ways to make money. So Miss Courtney, with that context there, you know, the NPCs and Miss Pinky Dolls and all that kind of money, is all money legitimate money?
If it can clear a check, the check clears. If the check clears, it's legit. Whoa.
Because, and I think You know what? Yeah, I think what sometimes frustrates me about these conversations, though, mm-hmm. is especially when it's women. Mm-hmm. When women are making money on the internet, all of a sudden,
exactly. And I do think, like, let's take it back a mm-hmm. second. This is very new.
Very.
It's very nouveau and it's very avant-garde. There, out of the box. Like, this is really outside of the box. And I remember when I first saw it, like, 2 days ago, and I was like, what's
that? Was too funny.
Yum.
Good day to be cute. Rene.
Have you seen this NPC like, stuff? And like, people are just swaying back and forth until you give them a gift. And I think, yes, the internet and the creation of new platforms, new technology, and just the innovation that exists in the digital space mm-hmm. is going to present us with new opportunities to monetize mm-hmm. and new ways to make money in a way that is completely unprecedented.
Yep.
I think if you had told somebody 20 years ago that one day you'll be able to put videos of yourself
yeah.
on the internet and make money from that, they would have told you absolutely not. Yeah, firstly, yeah, yeah. What is the World Wide Web?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I think it's interesting taking a step back and being like, this is new to me, but just because it's new doesn't necessarily make it wrong.
Right, right.
And I do think people may think it's stupid, like, oh, this is such a weird way to make money. But one thing you cannot deny is the money that she makes at the end of the stream, right? And so it's the same way that some of us can't believe that people are full-time gamers, right?
Yeah,
because
yeah,
it's just not our industry. We don't understand how people make money out of it. But for some people who have cracked that code and have been able to learn how to make money from these new innovations, it makes perfect sense how this is happening and how they're getting a slice of the pie, the very big pie that is technology and social media.
Yep.
And so personally, sis, you have mastered something which I would break character several times. It's interesting seeing the videos of when she does break character, because me, I would have been laughing, kikiing, but then am I prepared to make that kind of money? Do you go? I mean, it's a different kind of skill set. And so I do think it's just different. And I think people naturally, societies have challenge embracing difference.
Yep.
Now, I think the bit where it does become a little bit techie is when you are talking about things like sex work and like platforms like OnlyFans mm-hmm. and things that exist behind paywalls, which are, you know, definitely adult themed content. And I think that is a question more so about ethics, morality, and mm-hmm. where you stand in the consumption of that. But sex work is not new. Again, it's just applying new technology to very old ways of consuming people and consuming things and satisfying our own human desires, right? And so for me, is it legit money? Yes. Now, is it something, if I saw my younger sister online pretending to be an NPC for 4 hours a day, I'm gonna be looking at her like, this is the life path you're choosing for yourself. Okay.
You making money,
you doing your thing, cool, but is this really what you want to do? Because I do think it's worth talking about like the long-term impacts of these things and whether you are then able to not necessarily integrate, but whether you can truly separate your online persona and the things you do online from your real life person.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm not sure about Pinky Doll making that kind of numbers. She does not need a 9-to-5. But say
she might even need an investor soon.
She might need to walk into a whole JP and be like, you guys figure out how to some stocks, bonds, whatever you guys do. I'm going to go and yum. That's how I bring the money to the table. But it's the same with like rappers and stuff like that. At the same time, I think it's worth then asking yourself, and I guess entertainers at some point have to do this, right? Which is, if I do need to return to traditional forms of work, will I be able to, right? Knowing that this is my digital footprint, especially in a world where our digital footprint is just so linked to our personal brands and who we are and how we can then navigate the labor market, right? So walking into interviews, it's not uncommon for people to Google your name. Now, if people Google your name and it's now linked to an OnlyFans, or it's now linked to, you know, hours and hours of streams where you're pretending to be an NPC, you have to think, will this have consequences on my professional outcomes, right? Mm-hmm. And my future outlook. And I do think that's just worth considering, because as much as it may be easy and it may be quick money, which oftentimes the internet actually is not, because I've seen so many people doing these live streams as well, it's not having the same effect.
100%. Like, you gotta know
your market, you gotta do your thing. And she's just a businesswoman, right? And she's got a specific product which she's given to a specific target audience. But honestly, I think it's worth weighing up. As much as this is quick money, or this is, you know, big money or whatever, and it seems like easy money,
is this in line with where I want to be in mm-hmm, my future? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And if this does damage my, you know, future prospects or close certain doors, let's just say if this does close certain doors, like working a corporate job or whatever, how am I now preparing myself for a future when this may not be the in thing anymore? Because the thing about the internet is trends change all the time. Today yeah. you're an NPC. In 3 weeks, no one's going to give a damn about this trend. No one's going to get, apart from the people who like, this is a serious fetish. Mm. And so when, or if the income then declines, what are you going to do? Something like gaming and streaming, for example, there's always new games, or there's always iterations of old games, like 2K. People have been playing that for decades. Do you get what I mean? Like the NBA game or Mario. Do you get what I mean? Like people have been playing that all the time. Sonic, reiterations all the time. Are there going to be innovations that you can move forward with in this? I'm not too sure, right? And again, you then have to future-proof for yourself.
Yeah.
And so I do think, as much as we're living in an era where it's like, get money and get money by any means necessary, think about, is this integral, first of all, like integrity, your values, does this align with your core values as a person? Does this align with your values, your morals, your ethics? But also, does this actually set you up for longevity, right? Mm-hmm. How does this affect your future? Because the internet will not die, right? Yeah. This is going to be a part of your story. Yeah. So think about how it fits into your story and how you would explain it in about 10 years time.
Mm.
Yeah.
This is true. I think to speak to the other side of that, right, where there's the creators and there's women as creators, particularly online, I do feel that there's a disproportionate amount of judgment that is placed on a lot of women when it comes to thinking about the long-term trajectory of the things that they put out online.
Yeah.
So like when we're thinking of like figures, obviously the classic go-to figures that we think about online that are men, we think of your Andrew Tates and your Kevin Samuels, but there are also a lot of creators that are men that are peddling out content that could be questioned in the next 5-10 years.
I mean, 100%.
We're definitely not above board here. You know, mm-hmm. there's probably gonna be somebody 10 years time. Oh my God, I can't believe they said that.
Yeah.
Which is a test to time. But one thing that I have noticed, at least personally, is that we're seeing a lot of women disproportionately affected or targeted with those messages. I mean, thinking about some of the podcasts that I occasionally came across back in the day, now that my algorithm is all set up. But we would have panels of men having conversations with women who are sex workers or folks that we consider extreme that are kind of talking about, so what is your future and how would your kids feel about this? And this like almost very heavy-handed judgment of women that are creators online and the questioning of the legitimacy of the work that they do.
Yeah.
I think it can be quite unfortunate but also frustrating in those conversations, because it almost feels as though as women we have to be doubly careful of the, you know, the content or the things that we put online, whereas with a lot of other folks, but particularly men, it's almost as though whatever they put out online, they won't necessarily be penalized in the same way.
I hear that. And I completely agree with that. I think firstly, to outline what I was just saying is not specific to just female creators or like anything like that. Like this is actually more generally about creators. But also I think one, that's just male privilege, right? That's just patriarchy. And the world that we live in often reflects this, the internet that we're navigating reflects the social structures we're actually navigating in real life, right? And so you are going to have sexist things be coming out of those innovations. Just because it's an innovation doesn't mean it's free of any flaw, right? I also think that oftentimes with these as well, it's actually women who do thrive in these spaces more 100%. Than men. And so I get why now the highlight is more so, okay, so then what is the outcome for these women? Because often it is women that you see, because people consume women more, right? They consume women's bodies, women's sexuality, or women being sexual, often more than they do men. But I do agree, like there's often this sexist narrative, which is you guys shouldn't do that because you're damaging your future, when the one, we should flip the mirror and be like, well, who is actually consuming this content? Somebody. Though oftentimes it's actually men. The reason why these things are so lucrative is because men, and yes, a group, a proportion of women as well, are feeding into it and actually giving their money. I don't know if you heard of that story of this guy who subscribed to his wife's friends OnlyFans.
Yeah.
Yeah, like things like that. It's like, people will consume the content. And if there is a demand, someone's going to supply.
Right.
Someone is going to give the supply. And oftentimes people want the supply from women. Mm-hmm. But I do think it's worth also talking about how and highlighting how a lot of these people, like even Pinky Doll, they are entrepreneurs. They are people who have applied business principles, which are just core fundamental pillars of business, and just applied it to something which seems very niche or very new. And honestly, you got to give them their flowers, right? You actually have to give them the applause. And a lot of those skills are actually transferable if they can be packaged in a particular way. Mm-hmm. Now, mm-hmm. I do think there is a space for, without malice or without judgment, highlighting to someone that, okay, you actually do need to consider everything,
though,
which is, if this is going to be your public persona, especially if you're attaching your government name or your actual face to what it is that you do, it is going to affect your future in some way, because like I said, those things never die. Mm-hmm. But I also think it's worth journeying with people and saying, but what you can do is frame your CV in this way. If you ever do need to go into the corporate place or ask somebody for a job, right, or be interviewed for anything. But also there's wisdom in them being like, well, since you are an entrepreneur, do what a lot of very successful entrepreneurs who are bringing in 5-6 figures every day do, which is set yourself up for the future. Have you got the right insurance? Have you got a good accountant? Have you all of these things, which a lot of these men who sit on these panels probably do have, but don't say, because they don't want to equip women for long-term success. Instead, they want to criticize their short-term, well, not their short-term, but what has happened immediately and presently. And it's like, actually, if we wanted to have business conversations, it would be around, okay, here's the number to an accountant, here's the number to someone who could sort out a pension, here's the number to someone who can sort out life insurance, someone who can, you know, manage assets and get you into, you know, maybe buying properties or doing whatever with your money and investing. But often people don't want to do that, because like you said, they don't want to see these women as legitimate entrepreneurs, as disruptive people, as forward thinkers, and really give them the flowers for what it is they have done. But also I find that people are happy to sit on panels and criticize women without actually being invested in their overall success. And so really and truly, if you're not going to have a productive conversation with me about how I can make this thing better, but all you can do is actually criticize what it is I've done, when I'm only leveraging, I'm just leveraging what you do better, right? Because a lot of these people are using the internet. They are marketers at heart, but they don't have that same level of success. And often they'll point to, it's because you're doing something, you know, you're doing sex work. Right, and it's right. Okay, yes, that's true, because I found what I can sell and it may be unique to me, but nothing's actually stopping you from being successful using the same tools. And also the game is just the game, right?
The game is the game.
The game is just the game. And it also exists in different areas of business. It's like when we were talking about our influencers, you know, being canceled or whatever, or like, are we getting rid of influencers? And it's like, it's unfortunate to some, I guess, depends who you are, that like, some influencers are making more than medical doctors, but the game is the game. Do you get what I mean? I think a lot of people sit here and they point fingers at women and they're like, you know, you're so bad and you're so reckless.
That's the system, man. You need to go to the system.
Thank you. Like, you're so reckless for doing X, Y, Z. But if there's a system out there and you're living in hard economic times and something's presented to you that leverages something you already have, like your phone, you're going to do what you need to do to make your money. And these things exist. Now, it's not about whether we would do it. It's about, are you comfortable doing it? Yeah. And since you have done it, are you setting yourself up for the future? And are you doing this in a way that actually protects your well-being, right? Yeah. And protects you. That's our first interest, first and foremost. And so what I think would be better for those men on panels to do is, if you're not going to help me figure out the problems which you're pointing at, don't point at problems that aren't really there just because you disagree or you're upset that you're losing and I'm winning in this lane.
Personally, I think the men on panel should just cease and desist. I think we should defend the cease and desist orders immediately.
No, but I do think there's room for highlighting the reality of certain things.
I think there is room for that.
But it's
the intention, but also the framing of the entire conversation. Exactly. And I think also the projection too.
Exactly.
Because I think there's a lot of women, obviously, like, whether or not we agree with your profession is one thing, but I can also respect that there is a level of expertise behind it. And I think there's that, right? Like, when we do have the conversations on like legitimacy, it's, do I respect the fact that you are an expert at what you do? Or do I respect or see you as somebody that is a quote unquote an entrepreneur, or somebody that can make money from this kind of thing? No, a lot of people are seeing these women as like, they're just, you know, showing their body or what they're doing is easy, or like they're creating, basically they're not allowing these women to have a quote unquote craft just because they don't understand it, or they are actually victims of it.
Yeah, or so they're demeaning.
Demeaning what they do. And I think it's very, very unfair, especially because a lot of these platforms actually empower women and give them a lot more agency than, you know, like back in the day, if you wanted to do something like catered to like a fetish, for example, you would have to be under some kind of like power structure, which meant that, you know, even in terms of like revenue and stuff like that, you wouldn't get that directly. You'd have to.
The likelihood is you were being exploited.
Precisely. The likelihood is that you were being exploited. Things like trafficking, like there's just so much like darkness around that's associated with a lot of the work that folks do, that it's almost difficult for a lot of folks, but particularly men, to give women their flowers around specific skills, like completely their business acumen. Like how many people look at Pinky Doe and think, oh, she's actually, you know, you're an astute entrepreneur.
Exactly.
Like a lot more women now are waking up and being like, maybe I won't do exactly what you do.
But there's something I can learn from what you do.
There's something I can learn. And then also there's the conflation of the work that women do online and the fact that we're not making, we're almost likening everything to being demeaning. Like Pinky Doll, for example, folks are not taking her seriously, or like other folks like her, because they liken it to things like they don't give proper, what's the word?
Credit.
Yeah, they don't give proper credit to what she's basically an actress. Like she's essentially actually online. She's actually online, you know, being an
A one woman show.
Exactly. And there's also the lack of respect in people's actual humanity.
Yes.
Because even with the argument that some people come up with to defend Pinky Doll, which is, oh, but at least she's not like showing her body, or like she's not a quote unquote sex worker. And it's like, it's one thing to disagree with somebody's profession and disagree with what they do. And it's another thing to afford people basic respect as a human being. And I think that's where sometimes it becomes very tricky and very, it becomes a complicated discussion because as we're even critiquing and trying to defend, oh, actually it's women's right to do, you know, whatever they decide to do, and also have to sit with the accountability of what those actions, the consequences those actions will bring, we're still not affording people the basic humanity and the basic 100%. Respect that they actually deserve. And I think that's my biggest frustration with a lot of those panels. It's, you can disagree, and like even for us, like transparently, you know, we are women of faith. Mm-hmm. We don't believe that you should be doing in that kind of work at all. It's it's
sex
no.
work and stuff.
But if you
NPC,
choose
now, that's for that.
Yeah, there we go.
I can't lie to you.
We don't know the ethical concerns
on
that.
A lot of theology.
You know, there's a lot. You know what I'm saying? Even things like foot fetishes, like sending a photo
of
you
your feet.
Actually, that's lust. Last.
And I guess the NPC thing is, but then the other people who are don't lust over this, but just find it entertaining. That's just a gray area.
That's just,
you know, take that up with the Holy Spirit. No, but I
personal
agree.
Conviction is important.
I agree with what you're saying. Yeah. I think that the technology makes it easy to dehumanize people.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're on that road more and more. I mean, look how far we've advanced with technology, and now we're trying to even remove humans from the picture. Like, look at the advancement of AI and stuff like that. Like, technology and dehumanization
kind
of go hand in hand, because you're trying to create efficient systems, but also the amount of access we have to different people without the time and even the attention span to engage with them and find out about their humanity, right? And a lot of us are engaging, especially if you, not to take this left or deep, but like in a world where we're bombarded with a lot of sexual content everything is almost fetishized, it's easy to just objectify people and come to judgment as to who they are and what they're worth, right? Based off of what we've seen, whether we like them or we don't. And I think that that's what the problem is oftentimes with women operating in this sphere. People already objectify women. That's now even made worse or amplified when you now have technology as the barrier between you, and it's hard to then really register that the person you're seeing on your screen is actually a human being on the other side of an internet connection.
It's crazy. And even then, it's like, not just that, but I feel like we are doubly, what's the word, undervalued being a woman, right? Like, it just frustrates me. Those conversations frustrate me so much, because how can you hate that which you consume to this extent?
Yeah.
Because half of these folks will be talking about, you know, I would never want like somebody that I know doing and partaking in this activity. I hate what you do. And yet you have OnlyFans subscriptions or Pornhub subscriptions. It's just like, I just, the maths is not mathing. You're talking about you despise these women and you don't see them as credible entrepreneurs, and yet you're actively sowing into their pockets.
Yeah.
But they don't see it as actively sewing into their pockets. They see it as getting what they want.
And it's unfortunate because they're not just getting what they... I don't want to say that y'all are stupid, but it's given stupidity. Because you can't sit here and tell me, you like, I despise women, I hate everything that they do. Like, to me, it doesn't make logical sense. And this is why a lot of you guys need to sit with the cognitive dissonance that you have. You can't be telling me you hate women, you hate the work that they're doing, you hate that they're thriving, and yet you are sewing into them. Yeah. You need to see it as, look, what you spend money on. I remember ages ago, like, one of our pastors was like, go and print out like 3 months worth of like your bills or your bank account and what you spent money on. There you will find your treasure. Mm-hmm. There you will find what you actually, you know, hold dear to you. And I think a lot more people need to do that, because 100%. There are some things that you are like, you think are not important to you, or there are some things that you are disparaging but equally sowing into.
Yeah.
Of course, it's going to continue to, you know, facilitate more misogyny because it's almost like an internal power battle, really.
Exactly.
You're there fighting with the fact that you want to consume women, and perhaps that's what allows you to sleep at night. There you go. It's the fact that you need to objectify these women in order to consume them and actually justify and validate the fact that you are spending money and you are actually, you are sowing a seed into this entrepreneur.
And that's the root of the criticism, right? Which is, sorry, let's talk about pornography for a second.
Yeah.
When you consume pornography, you are consuming and dictating how you consume that person.
Right.
That person, and in these structures where people are exploited and they're trafficked and they are made into specific things and made to perform in a specific way in order to be the perfect consumable product. When we go searching for pornography, or men go, or people go searching for pornography, they're looking for something that they want to consume and they want it to be perfect for them. That then creates and breeds an entitlement, right? It breeds and it shapes the way you see people. You Ridiculous. See people as an object for your consumption, and they must be perfect objects for your consumption. And so then when you are confronted with a multidimensional person, which is a human being, and she's a woman, and you expect for her to be that perfect object which you consume on the internet at night, and she's not, right? And she's opposed to the things that you think are all things lovely and fantastic about femininity and women, then you become upset, because this is someone you can't just click away. This is not just a window you can close. This isn't an incognito tab you can just flick up on your phone and it's gone. This is a person who you can't just delete, right? They're actually a human being. You have to sit with that.
But I think that's what breeds the frustration right now.
But this is exactly what I was talking about in the Barbie analogy a couple of episodes ago, right? People want perfect consumable objects, and then when you cannot get rid of that thing from in front of you, right? And you actually have to have a conversation with them, you have to coexist with them. Gosh,
oh my god,
that's what breeds the frustration, right? And the anger and the visceral reactions you almost see from men who are like, how dare you be like this, and how come I cannot then eliminate you from my presence, right?
Go!
And that's why people seem so frustrated by women pursuing what they want, or just being themselves. It's just like, oh no, I want to find that perfect thing which I can consume, and you're not it. Get out of my sight. But you can't delete human beings. So that's the frustration, I think, and the anger that then brews within people. And it comes down to a lot of technology, a lot of the content we are consuming, and the way we consume content, sorry, is training us to consume and treat human beings in an inhumane way. And it's important for us to really instigate, when we see another human being, man or woman, but particularly these, you know, the groups of people who are on the negatively receiving end of like systemic oppression. When we see those people, what do we actually think about their humanity? Or do we just see them in stereotypes? Do we just see them in preconceived notions and ideals and profiles versus actual people?
And are we projecting? No, I absolutely love what you were saying. And I guess before we do wrap up the episode, I did want to touch on another kind of slightly I wouldn't say that it's away from some of the stuff we've touched on already, but it is a very interesting way to make money and find love at the same time. And perhaps that might be a way to remedy some of the situations reality that we have found. Maybe the incentive needed to be money, the 50 racks, the whatever. But we're seeing the blossoming of reality TV shows, especially around dating. We've had the Too Hot to Handle. We've had that was a mess. The Love is Blind. Yeah. There's the Love Islands. We've recently concluded a Love Island we're coming to the end of the most recent Love Island series in the UK, and it was just giving toxic top to bottom. Is that a legitimate way to find love and make money?
Is it a legitimate way to make money again if the check clears? I mean
they said
if it ain't illegal, bro, and the check clears, it's legit. It's legit. Do you get what I mean? So, but I think the issue is it a legitimate way to find love, right? But also, like, again, so the legit thing, the reason why I keep making a joke about it is literally there are so many, like, traditional ways that people make money, which we don't necessarily understand. It's like, oh, well, it's legit. Do you get what I mean? And I think the reason why people are like, is this legitimate? Is because it's new. We don't understand how it works. How did this,
and
the
also,
internet connection
to be, look,
become
to be
cash?
Fair, some of the things that we're taking as legit and established forms are not working for
exactly.
us. We even recently had a conversation on the average salary of the folks that are in the United Kingdom. And I want to tell you, it is a
the
sad
system. Is broken.
Sad.
The system is broken. But about reality TV, which I think is interesting, is the incentivization of falling in love, right? Which is, if you can fall in love with someone here, then you will give you £50,000, right? And how convincing can you make your relationship? Now, I don't know. Like, I'm sure there are loads of people who have gone on reality TV and, like, have found true love. I love me some Lauren and Cameron.
We love you guys.
I love me some Molly and Tommy from Love Island. I think it's one thing to go on
Damian
there and
India,
find legitimate
love.
Yeah, there you go. It's one thing to go on there and find legitimate love, right? But I think that that is a very small percentage. And I think this creating a system, which is if you fall in love, we'll pay you, definitely makes people start operating in a disingenuous way, right? When we start to see things as work or something that can make us money, we tend to brand ourselves, right? It's the same way when, like, code switching at work is a form of branding, right?
Because money
the way
you make.
Exactly. The way you present yourself in the office is different to the person who you are at home. Why? Because there's now money on the line. I ain't going to mess up my check. Then it's the same way when you're an influencer. You brand yourself in a certain way to make yourself more attractive of certain partnerships and certain sponsorship deals and people's attention. When you have money on the line when it comes to love, you tend to not act in your most authentic and genuine state, right? And that's why I think it's then an issue then trying to find genuine love and honest love on there. And even if you remove the money, I think simply having a place where people can have so much attention put on them and literally people have built their whole careers and forget about the money. So many people are going on Love Island now to build a career, right? The Molly May effect, right? Which is, if I can get myself in front of millions of eyes every night for 2 weeks, I'm gonna make some bank somewhere. Do you get what I mean?
Relationship or no relationship.
Thank you very much.
6 months later.
Thank you. And then
we had to break up.
And then you start using people more so as tools.
Right.
And accessories to your growth. And so I don't think it's the most productive way to fall in love. I do think it's a great way to make money though.
It's very incentivizing. I can't lie
to you.
If you told me you were going to give me 50K and I had to fall out, baby, we're going to fall in love.
I'm a fall in love with anybody. I don't even have to like you. Do you get what I mean? And also, these things are all within, like, money-making systems and people who are creating stories and spinning stories producing something that's very compelling for the viewer. And so I don't think it's the best place to find legitimate love. Is it a good place to make legitimate money? I mean, I wouldn't hedge my bets on it.
If the check clears.
Do you know what I mean? But if the check clears and it works for you, then it works for you and it sets you up for your future. But I do think it should inform, or you should think about how it then informs how you interact with love and whether you see love as transactional or something that must come with some kind of incentive. And I think we can see it play out more these days in terms of, like, the dating scene, right?
Absolutely.
Which is, well, what can I actually get out of this situation versus trying to make genuine relationships and connections with people for them being people and not just people who can offer you things.
Yeah, no, I completely hear it. To close out this episode, Courtney, I have one question and one question for you only. Would you ever sell pictures of your feet online?
I have lovely feet, by the way, guys. Like, I actually have beautiful feet. But no, I would not.
Do you think there would be any circumstance or anything that could compel you or move you to sell pictures of your feet online?
I don't think it's in line with my religious values.
And that is a legitimate answer right there, ladies and gentlemen, CDB. As for me, myself,
How about you?
No, I actually have, like, I've been keeping this in for a really long time, but... Mm,
that's not very accountable.
I know. There actually are some photos of my feet online presently. Wow.
You should send that to me so I can put it on the... on the screen.
Subscribe to my link if you'd like to see some more feet photos. No, I'm completely trolling, guys. Absolutely. I too also have lovely feet. I really like well-kept feet, like pedicures and all that kind of stuff, but I won't be selling pictures for the foreseeable future. It is in line with my current and hopefully future values that I would not be selling my feet pics.
Not possible.
But if you want to sell your feet pics, sister, then, you know, we ain't gonna run to stop you.
I mean, personally, I would not encourage you to.
We
wouldn't endorse.
We aren't endorsing. Yeah. And we are, especially for our Christian sisters, you gotta cover those feet, baby. You gotta stop. For the rest of y'all, you do what you do. You're outside of our jurisdiction.
Outside of our reasoning,
outside of our realm, we neither send you off nor but anyway, sisters, we would love to hear your thoughts on the latest crazes on how to make that money. Are these quote unquote legitimate ways to make money? Are women the ones being disproportionately targeted? Do you see them as entrepreneurs? Have you ever shared feet pics?
Honestly, and if you have, you definitely have disposable income to buy some live show 110 tickets. To maybe even sponsor some for others.
That is a great idea. Oh my goodness. Such a great idea. There was actually one TikToker, I'll send you the video, who did like a come with me. She did like a come with me to fulfill somebody's foot fetish. And the only thing that she had to do was, like, he was like covered in a mask and everything, and she just had to put her foot in his mouth.
Oh yeah, I've seen stuff like
that. Oh my god.
Yeah, or like kick them that and like stuff like that.
It was literally the most hilarious thing I've ever seen, but I ain't kick shaming anybody.
Honestly,
you know,
at the end of the day, we're all gonna meet our maker.
There you go.
It's an individual conversation. I'm gonna be concerned about myself.
We ain't trying to be up in anybody's business. So if you like feet, especially the brothers listening, because I'm hearing it's a thing. if you like feet, that's your own personal business, and that is something to take up with your personal savior.
There we go.
That's it. That's
honestly
it.
Be merry, glow and grow.
Glow and grow,
all
as they
over
say.
Your body. It's you. It's your
alone or with people. That's your own personal prerogative. Anywho, coming to the conclusion of this episode, ladies, please come over to support us over on our social channels at To My Sisterhood for literally everything. That's where you will find us. Yeah. That is where you will find everything. Yeah. You won't find those live show tickets just yet, though. You have to go to the mailing list for that.
Like,
but
we said,
we're going to
Friday.
Talk about that.
They're out on Friday.
But please also come and follow the lovely lady who also does not have any feet pics on the internet as of yet, at CD Bartek.
Never. What?
You were smiling and then you were like, what did she say?
Oh my gosh. Let me not close a whole door, though. I might not be able to.
That's why anyway, I said, heaven for
never but sell my is- savior.
That was
you are why I want you, treasure.
That was so Guardian. Hey, God. We're a lifelong Christian, guys. We're in it for the long haul. Check back in 10 years' time to see if there's any feet pics of Eva, Courtney, or Renee. That's how you know TMS went down. Come follow us.
That's how you know you guys weren't listening to them ads. You guys need to listen to the ads.
Do you guys want us out here like that? Biggest fans, anyways, at CD Bartek, at Renee Kapuku. That's it, man.
And make sure that you sign up to the mailing list. Honestly, we're going to send you the link once it drops straight to your inbox. And so please, tomysisters.com. We'll also send you weekly glowing and growing tips. Trust me, it's not just about announcements. It's also about love letters straight to you, okay? And so definitely sign up to the mailing list. Sisters, we hope that you have a beautiful and amazing week and that your money does step up in, you know, the Lord blesses you.
Hallelujah. Okay?
Hallelujah. All right. Have an amazing week. We love you so much. Keep glowing and growing.